Hey, it's Cole Smith here from PhotoshopCafe.com. So today I'm going to show you how to shoot a lunar eclipse. I've previously done one on a solar eclipse, and so the good news about a lunar eclipse is you don't need specialized gear to view it. You can view it with your naked eye. Unlike a solar eclipse where you need to have the special glasses and you don't want to look directly at it because you'll be blinded, the lunar eclipse, you can look at it, you can enjoy it, you can look at it through binoculars, and you can photograph it with your camera or your mobile phone without the use of any special filters. Just look at it and enjoy it. So I'm going to share the basics of how you can photograph it, and then we're going to go more in depth using different types of equipment to get better shots, and I'm going to tell you why. By the way, this is not a sponsored video. I am not sponsored or supported by the makers of any of this equipment. This is my own gear that I use. So what is a lunar eclipse? So a lunar eclipse is really simple. It's essentially the light source, which would be the sun shining. Then we have the earth. The light is shining into the earth, and then we see the moon. Now, as you see, that moon is going to be illuminated. And that's what you see as a full moon. As the moon moves into the earth's shadow, notice how it starts to get darker until it's completely behind the Earth's shadow. We can still see the moon. And the reason it turns red is because you're seeing all the Earth's sunrises and sunsets at the same time that are bouncing up to give it that color. And then as it comes out, we start to see the normal moon again. And so for you flat earthers, that would be a mic drop. Some things to bear in mind when we want to photograph the moon. Now, you can photograph the moon any day, and I would definitely recommend that you do that. Practice photographing the moon. Now, one of the things you're going to find, though, once it goes into an eclipse, it's going to be darker, so we're going to have to change some of the settings, and it's going to be a little bit more tricky. But first of all, let's talk about photographing the moon. Now, you could be shooting with a smartphone. You could be shooting with a DSLR camera, mirrorless camera, whatever camera you want to use. So unless you're just, you know, photographing with your phone like that and just doing regular shots, which you could, if you want to get better shots, you're going to need a tripod. So I have a couple of different configurations here. This one here is a little bit more pricey. This is a Gitzo tripod with a really right stuff head. Now, I love these really right stuff. And the reason for that is if you look at the bowl on here, as I loosen that, it's a very, very large bowl. And the thing I like about that is normally when you put a camera on and you've got a longer lens, it's heavier. And sometimes you put the camera on and it just kind of settles. You know what I'm talking about. So you might have to just kind of pull it back a little bit, tighten it, and then let it settle in. This big bowl head here does not move. So you pop it in, it's going to stay on there no matter what. So this head is not going to just adjust when it goes on. It's very solid. It can support a lot of weight. And it's very easy to position your camera and then just lock it in, and it's not going to move. Now, if that's a little bit out of your price range, you can get lower cost ones. This particular one here, I really like. This is my favorite travel tripod. And this is a Vanguard VO3 carbon fiber tripod. The thing I love about it is it folds up very, very small. So it's a small footprint. I can put that on my backpack, or I can even put it inside a suitcase when I travel. And so you can loosen it off, and you can see it's a 5-piece leg, so it can go quite long and quite tall. And I like these round ones like this, so I can just kind of do that. The other type, you know, with the catches, I don't like this because I get bitten by those a lot. So this works nicely. The carbon fiber is nice. The other thing I like about this particular tripod is it's got an adjustable center pole. So that means that I can get either extra height, or I can do adjustment without having to adjust all the legs individually. And this one is relatively inexpensive. You can get from B&H for under $300. This also comes with the plate. It's an Arca Swiss plate, which can just kind of pop in here, and it goes onto your camera, obviously. The thing I like about this plate is it has the mounting screw here just to put in your quarter 20 on your camera. But it also has another mode where it can pop open here, and you can put a smartphone in there. And I love being able to do that, because if you're shooting with a smartphone and you want to get better photography, if you can get some kind of a tripod, then you can use a night sight or the night mode to get better night photography. So let's talk about cameras. I've got a couple of different cameras here. I've got my older camera, which is a Canon 5D Mark IV. And you can see as it's got the 70 to 200 L lens on there, works really well. Now with this, I just usually put them backwards. It's good for traveling. But then when you were photographing, it's nice to get that lens hood on, because that could be like perhaps, you know, you're shooting and a car headlight hits the edge, or some kind of a light can hit there and you can get flare on there. So this will help reduce that. Of course, if you're in a pitch black location and there's no light pollution, you probably don't have to worry about that too much. And this is the Sony A1 with the 70 to 200 Mark II. This is the 2.8 G Master. It's actually quite a light lens. It's much lighter than it looks. One important thing, when you get the lens hood, you cannot use it with the lens hood on backwards because you can't access the manual focus in some of these buttons. So you definitely want to kind of flip that around, put it on. Even though you can pop this little door open and that lets you go in and adjust like a circular polarizer, which you won't be using for lunar eclipses. All right. The other thing about these lenses is when you mount them, you'll notice, yes, you can mount by the camera, but you'll see that we have this collar here. When you're mounting a heavier lens on a tripod, you always want to mount by the collar. It's going to give better balance and it's not going to have all the weight on the front. So that's really important. You'll notice that on all of them. Now, you're obviously going to go with what lenses you have and what you can afford. That 200 millimeter is going to be okay. You're going to get some reasonably good moons there. But if you really want to zoom in, you want to magnify more. So maybe you pick up a longer lens. This is the Canon 400. It's a fixed 5.6, so it's not an expensive lens, but it does give you some extra reach. If you don't have the budget for a more expensive lens, you can get these extenders. So this is the 2x extender here for the Sony, and this is the 2x extender, I believe. Yep, the 2x extender for the Canon. Now, when you're using these extenders, it's important what you want to do is you want to take the extender. First of all, you're going to attach it to the lens. All right. And this is going to effectively turn this into an 800 millimeter. Then once you've attached it to the lens, then you can take this off, attach it to the camera. So the extender obviously is not going to work as well as a native 800 lens. One of the disadvantages is you're going to lose a little bit of light. You're not going to be able to open the aperture up as much. And the other thing is some people say they can soften the images. In my experience, this particular Canon actually works really well, and I didn't notice much softening from it. Same thing goes to the Sony, you know, the 2x extender. So that's a low budget way of increasing that. Now, what if, say, maybe you're on a Sony camera and maybe you're transitioning from Canon and you want to use this Canon lens, you already have it, you don't want to buy another lens, then we can use something like here, this is the MetaBones adapter. So I can put this MetaBones adapter, I'm going to attach it to the camera first. Then I'm going to take the lens and I'm going to attach it onto here. And then I can use the Canon lenses on the Sony. And now there's different adapters for all types of different cameras and lenses. So if you're not using a super long lens that often and you're shooting between different brands, you don't necessarily have to go out and buy an expensive lens. Last piece of equipment before we talk about settings, and that is a remote release. So once you've got the camera on the tripod, you don't want to be pushing the shutter button because that's going to create a little bit of shake. So you're going to use this remote here. This is for the Canon. There's ones for the Sony and also through the app. I can actually use the Sony app on my A1 camera and I can trigger it remotely. If you don't have that, you could use the self-timer. Just do a 30-second countdown, 15-second countdown, and then just use that self-timer to do it. Because one of the things you will notice is when you get this heavier lens and you pop that onto the tripod, take a little second for that to settle. Because the longer you're shooting, the more sensitive the camera is to camera shake. So definitely use that remote release. So let's talk about shooting the moon. So the first thing you want to do is you want to get your focus. So before the eclipse, maybe you want to get your moon there, use your autofocus, and then get that focus tack sharp. Then at that point, switch it to manual focus and don't change it. Just lock it in there. Now, some of the cameras allow you to zoom in and magnify here to check your focus. So you might want to go into manual focus and tweak it. But generally speaking, that autofocus is going to nail it really good. Turn it into manual focus and just lock it in. And because the moon is not really getting that much closer to the Earth, that your focus is going to change at that point. So in order to capture light on your camera, you have your lens, you have your sensor. So there's three settings, and you've maybe heard of that, the exposure triangle. So talking about the exposure triangle, there's three settings that are going to affect your photographs and how bright they are, how much exposure you get. So let's start with the aperture on the lens. That's the opening on the lens that opens. The larger that opens, the more light comes in. And that's the f-stop. The f-stop is how large is that aperture open? Is it a small opening or is it a large opening? That determines how much light comes in. Then there's the shutter speed, is how long is that open for to let that light in. The longer it's open, the more light comes in, the more the image is exposed. The shorter duration, it's going to be less exposure and it's going to be a darker image. Then there's the third factor, which is the sensor. The sensor is what's collecting light. And on there, that's where we set the ISO. So a higher ISO makes that sensor more sensitive, which means it's going to capture light more quickly, which means in a darker setting, you're going to want to open up that ISO to a higher amount, which is going to catch more light. When it's very bright, you want to drop it down to a lower ISO so it's less sensitive and it's not going to capture as much light. So to find the right setting, there is a trade-off with the three of these, right? So if the aperture is open too much, sometimes you can get a softening of the image. If it's not open enough, you're not going to get enough light in and you're going to have to compensate with the other setting. So let's talk about the shutter speed. If the shutter speed is too fast, it's not going to get enough light. If the shutter is open for too long, as the moon is moving and the earth is spinning, you're going to get motion blur. So you're going to get a softening of your image. Then the third thing is the ISO. If the ISO is too high, you're going to get noise. You're going to get grain in your image. If it's too low, obviously, you're not going to get enough light. So let's talk about some recommended settings. So some of the recommended settings I would say is the shutter speed. You want to keep that to about 1/125th of a second or faster. Any slower than that, you could be getting some motion blur or softening when you zoom into that photograph. So let's set that to 1/125th of a second. Then the next thing you're going to do is you're going to open up that aperture. So try to find out what the sweet spot is for the aperture on your lens. Every lens has a sweet spot where it's at its sharpest. So go as far open as you can within that sweet spot. And then finally make the adjustment to the ISO to get the correct exposure. If the image is looking great, then you're good to go. But if it's looking noisy or grainy because you have to turn the ISO up even higher, now you might make some compromises where perhaps you're going to open up that aperture a little bit more. That's probably the next thing I would do. Open up that aperture, let more light in, then see if you can get the right balance by adjusting the ISO. And when none of those are working, you might have to slow down that shutter speed a little bit. So sometimes there's going to be a compromise somewhere. Maybe you're going to get a little bit of motion blur, or maybe you're going to get a little bit of softening, or maybe you're going to get a little bit of noise. But remember, we do have really good sharpening and noise reduction inside Lightroom. Personally, I'd rather be applying a little bit of sharpening than I would noise reduction. But using those settings, you should get a pretty good exposure. Now, if you want to really get a good crisp image and you want to step it up a little bit, you could get a Sky Tracker or a Star Tracker. And what this does is I mount it on the tripod and it will move with the moon. And by doing that, you can now shoot with a slower shutter speed and you don't have to worry about the motion blur because this is going to be moving with it. So now you can set your aperture to the sweet spot. You can use a lower ISO and a slower shutter speed. And then you can follow that and get a really nice, crisp image. Now, of course, there's different ways of shooting. You might be shooting star trails. Maybe you're shooting wider and allowing the star trails. You probably don't have to worry about the motion blur as much. And so you could also use this tracker to move with the moon and maybe do a slow shutter speed and pick up some star trails along the way. So you might be shooting nice and close and trying to get those nice, big, crisp images of the moon. You might be shooting wider and looking for star trails with the moon. You might be shooting just into the sky by itself, or you might be looking for some kind of a foreground element, maybe some mountains or some trees or something in there for a composition. These are all personal tastes and personal choices that you can make. The important thing is that when you go to shoot the moon, you're looking for a place that's as dark as possible. And so, you know, try to get away from the city if possible. And also you're looking for a clear sky. So you maybe go out into the desert or somewhere where it's clear and it's dry. You don't have a lot of haze. You don't have clouds. You don't have that. If you can get a good crisp night sky like that, you're going to get a really good exposure. But if you don't have that, you're just going to do the best you can. So I've shot several lunar eclipses And I've shot them from the city, from outside my garage before, and got a pretty decent exposure, a pretty good shot. So what you're going to do is you're going to do the best you can with what you have. So I'm going to put links underneath to this gear and some other gear from B&H that you guys can check out. So one of the things I like to do is I like to shoot a sequence of images in the different phases and then put them together. And in fact, I made a tutorial for that in Photoshop and Lightroom here where you can see how to process that and put it together. So drop a comment underneath and let me know if you learned anything. And also if you have any questions, drop them there. If you're new, welcome to the cafe. Hit the subscribe button, turn on notifications, you won't miss any of my tutorials. And until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.